Hello students, today I am going to recap the geography for class 7. Whatever we have learned in the previous video, today I am going to recap. This video is for the summary of the chapters that have been studied in the previous video. Now let's see. The first chapter is the representation of the earth surface, in which we have written here some points that are the map, scale, topographic map, grid, features of map. Okay, now so first of all, what is map? We have already learned it about it. The map is a representation of the earth surface. Map is the representation of the earth surface or part of the earth surface on the flat surface. It is known as map. And we have already learned it, the types of map. There are the three types of map: political map, physical map, and thematic map. Okay, and we have learned about it. Now there are some features of the map that are the scale, direction, symbol, and you can say color. These are the some features of the map. Then what is the scale? Scale is the relation between the ground distance and the map distance. Means whatever we are measuring the distance, like if we want to draw the map of the India, but it is impossible to draw the exact distance on the plain paper at the small paper. So we use the scale. Means we write 100 kilometer as a 1 centimeter. Okay. Now the topographic map. What is the topographic map? Topographic map is the map which shows the artificial features of the land and the natural features of the land. Means artificial feature of the earth and the natural feature of the earth. Actually, this is a large scale map. You know, large scale map means we show the small area with the gray detail. Means it gives the gray detail. For example, if you want to draw the topographic map of the Muzaffarpur, you will easily show on it where it is the pond, where it is the other places, rivers, dam, malls, etc. Means this is the large scale map. Scale topographic map is a large scale map which shows the small area with the gray detail. Now what is grid? Actually, grid is the network of the lines. This is the vertical lines and the horizontal lines. You know, in the videos, in the lectures, we have studied about it. The vertical line is called the northing, vertical line is called the easting, and the horizontal line is called northing. And the intersection of these lines, means easting and the northing, form a cell. Okay, and the whole net of the easting and the northing is called a grid. Now some features of the map are like convectional symbol. Actually, convectional symbol are the symbol which is agreed by the all countries, means internationally agreed. Means for example, if we use symbol for like this, means this is a temple symbol. This shows the temple. Means it is a internationally agreed. Means all the country has accepted to use the symbol. So they are the conventional symbol. Actually, the exact shape of the particular thing, like you can say plateaus, mountains, or different pond, rivers, it can't be shown on the map. So we use the symbols, and these symbols are agreed with the all countries. So this is known as conventional symbol. We use also colors. Colors actually shows the different shape, like we use water bodies. Water bodies is shown by the blue color, and dry water body is shown by the black. Okay, and brown color is shown. Brown color is shown, but the plateau or mountain. Okay, now we come in the next chapter, that is the atmosphere. Okay, the atmosphere. What is atmosphere? Actually, atmosphere means this is the blanket of air. This is the blanket of air surrounded the whole earth surface. Means this is a like a blanket. Means if we are living here on the earth surface, and it is surrounded by the airs, and these airs is called atmosphere. And the composition of atmosphere, we have learned it about in the videos, that composition means there are the mainly two gases. There are mainly two gases which compose the atmosphere, that is the nitrogen and the oxygen. Nitrogen is 78% and oxygen is 29%. The remaining 1% contains other gases like water vapor, you can say ozone, carbon dioxide, helium, etc. Now, there is the layer of atmosphere. Means there are the five layer of atmosphere, you know. The five layer of atmosphere, in which lowest atmosphere is the lithosphere. Lowest atmosphere is the troposphere, or it is about 18 kilometer above the earth surface at the ground, and at the water, you can say at the pole. Means from the pole it is about 8 kilometer, and every weather changes occurs in this layers, and only life can exist in this layer. Next is the stratosphere. Stratosphere is about 50 kilometer above the troposphere. It's 50 kilometer above the troposphere. It is the stratosphere is a sphere in which we can fly the airplanes, because there is a very low density of the air. Okay, and in this stratosphere is very important. Atmosphere, in the stratosphere there is another layer, that is the ozonosphere, and ozonosphere contains the ozone gas which protects us from the ultraviolet ray. Ozone is a gas of the ozone. Ozone is a gas, and that is formed by the three atoms of oxygen. Okay, now the next one is the mesosphere. You know, the mesosphere is the third layer of the atmosphere, which is about 80 kilometer above the stratosphere. This is about 80 kilometer. Okay, 80 kilometer, and the mesosphere contains all the meteors that comes from the higher atmosphere from the sky. It comes in the mesosphere, and it start burning. Next one is the thermosphere. Thermosphere is the sphere in which it is about 450 kilometer above the earth surface. It is about 450 kilometer above the earth surface, and here the temperature is very high. The temperature increases very rapidly. And the last is the exosphere, and exosphere is also known as the ionosphere. Means ionosphere is from the stratosphere to the exosphere, and it is 1000 kilometer above the earth surface. It contains the ions. Means all the gases in this layer break down into ions, and it is very important for the transmission of the radio and the TV signals. Next one is the importance of the atmosphere. You know, the importance of atmosphere, that first of all, the carbon dioxide, nitrogen, oxygen, and the other gases. Means carbon dioxide is important for the temperature maintenance and for the photosynthesis of the plant. You know, the nitrogen is essential for the growth of the plant, and the ozone sphere, you know, ozone gas is very important for the because it protects us from the ultraviolet ray coming from the sun. Okay, now the next one is the greenhouse effect. Actually, greenhouse effect is due to the carbon dioxide, because carbon dioxide is heavier gas, it traps the sunlight and make the earth surface warm. In the cooler areas, in the warm colder areas, the plants are grown in the greenhouse effect. Means plant, the seeds germinate and it begin to grow. Then greenhouse effect is used because it maintains the temperature and help in the growth of the plant. But when the greenhouse gases, like greenhouse gases is the carbon dioxide, when it increased, when it goes higher, means rise up, then it is very dangerous for the environment. We it causes the global warming. Global warming is nothing. Global warming is nothing. This is the increase in the temperature of the earth surface globally. Means when the earth surface temperature of the earth surface rises globally, rises higher, it causes global warming. Global warming causes many things, like when the global warming increase, the ice cap of the poles and the glacier will get melt, and it causes flood, and it can destroy the whole earth. Okay, now next topic is the ozone depletion. You know, the ozone depletion is caused by the main gases like CFCs, carbon, chlorofluorocarbon. CFCs, it is emitted from the refrigerator and the air conditioner, and it stick to the cloud and get a reaction with the ozone sphere and deplete the ozone. So we should protect the atmosphere. To protect the atmosphere, we must have to take care of everything, like more and more. We should plant more and more trees. We should not misuse the energy that we have, and we should use the solar energy and instead of the electrical energy and the fossil fuel. Okay, the next chapter means next chapter that has been that have to study for the first term, that is the Europe. Let's see. Now the next chapter is Europe. Yes. We have written here some key points. Let's see. First of all, location. Location, everyone, where is the Europe located? Actually, if we see the location of the location of the Europe on the globe, we will find the most part of the Europe lies in the northern hemisphere, and the some part and lies in the western hemisphere, and the most of the part lies in the eastern hemisphere. You can say, means the Europe lies in the northeastern hemisphere. Okay, now this is a peninsular countries, peninsular continent, because it is surrounded by the three sides with the water. That is in the north side the Arctic Ocean, in the west side the Atlantic Ocean, in the south that is the Mediterranean Sea and the Caspian Sea. So these are surrounded by the three sides, so it is known as the peninsular country. Okay, now if we talk about the location, means location means latitudinal extension is 36 degree north to 70 degree north. 36 degree north latitude to 70 degree north latitude, and longitude, that is 10 degree west to 60 degree east. 60 degree east means this lies in the totally in the north eastern hemisphere, with 30 degree north latitude to 70 degree north latitude. Means this is lying in the northern hemisphere, and the longitude, this bit C, 10 degree west. Only the some part lies in the western hemisphere, and 60 degree east. Okay, now we divide the whole continent into the different political division, we divide into different countries. We have grouped the countries in the different categories, like Scandinavian countries. Scandinavian countries, the northern part of the continent is called known as the Scandinavian countries, like Sweden, Norway, Finland, etc. And the some countries are the low countries. Low country means the land, the country which lies below the earth, below the sea level, is called low countries. And this low country, you can see this is the some part of the western country is the low country. Which one is the Balkan state? Balkan state is the state which lies between the southeastern part of the Europe, near the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea. Actually, this is the Balkan states are the very fertile. Now the next one is Baltic states. Baltic states are the states which lie around the Baltic Sea. So these are known as the Baltic states. Okay. Now physical features. These physical features is divided into four parts. That is the northwestern highland, central lowland, central upland, and alpine mountain. The northwestern highland means, you know, this is the word northwestern. Means the sub the northwestern part of the Europe have the many highlands, and this is the very eroded highlands. Means this is now not have the sharp peak. Now this is a eroded due to the glacier and the winds. Okay, so they are the very old and no any peak. Now central lowland. Central lowland means this is a stretch from the Ural Mountain to the Atlantic coast. Means that the eastern part is the very broad, and the southern the western part is a deeper. Means the western part is a narrower. Or this is the very fertile, and because this is a drained by the many rivers. These are drained by the many rivers, and the rivers deposited the minerals here. So these are very fertile, and the maximum agriculture activity is occur in this region. Means in this central lowland, many agriculture activity occurs. Okay. Now the next one is the central upland. Central upland means talk about the central upland. There are the some highland in the central part, that is the there are the some plateaus in the mountain, that is the Meseta central in the Spain, massive central in the France, Bohemian massive in the Czech Republic, and other mountains lie in this region. And this in this region there are the very swift rivers which come across the these mountains and form a you can say there is also a plain, that is known as intermountain plain. Okay, now the alpine mountain system. If we talk about the alpine mountain system, there are several mountain peaks. This is the series of the mountains. So if we see the map of the Europe, you will see there are the many mountains. There are the Sierra Nevada, Cantabrian mountain, Pyrenees mountain, okay, Mont Blanc, Dinaric. Means there are the many mountains you can see on the map, and this is very important because you are asked in the examination. If a map work is given in the question, then there will be it from the map. So see the all mountains and practice at home. Now there is agriculture. Means resources means agriculture. We are talking about the agriculture. The most part of the Europe is the cultivable land. Means the land which are not cultivable are also make it cultivable. Means they have a resources, so it make it cultivable. So most part are the cultivable, and the central part of the Europe are the very fertile land, you know. And the central lowland part, you can say नीदरलैंड पार्ट देर इज अ वेरी नॉट फर्टाइल नॉट यूजेबल फॉर द एग्रीकल्चर बट ड्यू टू द रिसोर्सेज एंड टेक्नोलॉजी दे ऑल्सो कम इन द यूज. ओके नाउ देर आर द मेनी एग्रीकल्चर एक्टिविटीज वी हैव लर्न इन द videos that there are the many agriculture like intensive agriculture and the extensive agriculture. Intensive agriculture are the agriculture which is done on the small region, small area having the very high population density, and extensive agriculture are done in the large farm where the population density is very low. Intensive agriculture has done due to for the consumption of the people, and the extensive agriculture is commercial agriculture. Okay, now there are the many agriculture activities, many agriculture activities like domestication of the animals, production of the grains, etc. Now, minerals and fossils. Actually, Europe is a very powerful continent due to they have minerals and the fossil fuel. They have the very large resources of the minerals and fossil fuel. So there are the industrial revolution happen in this Europe. There are the many industrial industries like the cotton industry, agro based industries, mineral based industries, and the forest based industry. We have talked about in the videos. Means agro based industry, you know. Agro-based industry are the industries which totally depend upon the agriculture for the raw material, and the mineral-based industry are the industry which depend upon the minerals for their raw material. Means the Europe has a large quantity of the minerals and the fossil fuels. They are very fertile, so there are the very you can say developed countries. Transportation and the cities. Where Europe is the largest continent having the network of the roads and the tracks. Okay. This was the summary for the three chapter of class 7. Now we will meet in the next chapter. Thank you and have a nice day.